Okay, so Boris Spassky. Now, I have to say that he's kind of the forgotten world champion. You know, we tend to overlook him, particularly in the United States, because, you know, Fischer beat him, and that's kind of all, his whole purpose for existing is to provide a backdrop for Fischer's, you know, culmination of his journey to world champion. But Spassky, actually, when I was researching, was the chess player that elicited the most sympathy. His story elicited more sympathy than any other player I've researched thus far. And I think that's partly because of his attitude. You know, Aliakhin could be kind of pompous, and Nimzowitsch could be super opinionated, and had that little spat with Tarash, et cetera, et cetera. But Spassky just got along with people. You know, Tal did as well, and Spassky and Tal were close friends, actually. But Spassky was just a cheerful guy who was subjected to some pretty extraordinary stuff, which we're going to get into. So one day I'm going to actually update these pictures, but there you go with who we are. So Boris Spassky is the first chess player that we've looked at who's still alive. He is obviously quite old. He's in his late 70s, but and
he has some cool white hair.
Yeah, well, that he was on Russian TV, so they had the makeup and the hairstyle and everything going. But that's him in 2013. He was on a television program in Russia, and you know, he was giving his opinion on a famous Russian musician. And he is in fairly good health. He had a couple of strokes, you know, which we'll talk about. And he doesn't really go out in public very much anymore. He doesn't really do a lot of appearances. But he is still alive, probably owing to his really, really strong emphasis on his physical health throughout his life. So as we talked about in the Soviet School of Chess, we need to take you back to the Siege of Leningrad. Spassky was born in 1937 in St. Petersburg, which was Leningrad at the time. And at the age of five, the Germans advanced to the outskirts of Leningrad and began a siege. Now, right before this happened, a lot of people were evacuated. Spassky was one of the lucky ones. He and his parents were evacuated. And he took a train to evacuate, and it's a good thing he did, because conditions in St. Petersburg were absolutely dreadful during the 872 days of the siege, particularly during the winters. We talked in the Soviet school lecture about Romanovsky and how his family passed away, and he was the only died of hunger, and he was the only one left when a rescue party came and found him. Part of the reason is that they had no food. The daily ration was 125 grams of bread. That's about 5 ounces of bread a day, and you had to find whatever food you could elsewhere. So people were boiling leather, they were scraping the wallpaper off the walls to eat the glue because it was potato-based. There was reports of, and founded reports we found, of cannibalism. It was desperate times. Leningrad was nearly destroyed. Hundreds of thousands of people died during the siege and during the bombardment. Spassky luckily made it out during that time. You may remember from the Soviet school lecture that Korchnoi's father was a truck driver going across the frozen Lake Ladoga, and died when an artillery shell bust a hole in the ice that his truck fell through, and he sank to the bottom. So this is something that profoundly impacted not just Spassky, but Soviet chess in general, because Leningrad was kind of a home. It was the more important of the two cities for Soviet chess, and it took a big hit. Moscow did not, because Moscow did not suffer the same siege that Leningrad did. So Spassky evacuated with his family to Kirov, which, as you can see, is far into the interior of the country, about 870 miles from St. Petersburg, and he lived there in a children's home. Actually, on the train, Spassky's 5 years old, he learns to play chess, sees some people playing chess, and observes. And then at the children's home in Kirov, he saw the older boys playing chess, and he became fascinated with it. Lived there for 4 years until the Siege of Leningrad finally ended. You saw it lasted over almost 3 years. And then he returned to St. Petersburg with his family and started taking chess very seriously. So 9-year-old Boris Spassky returns back to St. Petersburg, where he becomes something of a child prodigy. Now, it's interesting to see, and to kind of compare and contrast the trajectories of Fischer and Spassky, because both of them distinguished themselves as young children, and both of them worked their butts off to do it. So at nine, Spassky is back in St. Petersburg, and he's going to the Young Pioneers Palace, and this is about the fifth time we've mentioned the Young Pioneers Palace. We talked about it with Nimzowitsch, we talked about it with Tal, we talked about it with Botvinnik, we talked about it with Petrosian, and now we're talking about it again with Spassky. He learned chess there, and he studied under different masters, but mostly he just spent many hours each day studying chess. The report is that he was spending 3 to 4 hours a day studying chess at age 10. And so at age 10, when Botvinnik came to St. Petersburg to give a simul, we have Spassky, who took a game off of him. And this is another recurring theme. If you can take a game off of a GM as a in a simul, watch that child carefully, because chances are they are going places. So at 10, he takes a game off of Botvinnik. At 15, he's a Soviet master, which makes him stronger than most everyone in the world, because the criteria for a Soviet master was quite high. And then at 18, he gets the formality of being considered a grand master. That's because he automatically won a seed into the candidates tournament, and they had to confer upon him the title of international grand master, because only international grand masters participated in candidates matches. And just a couple of other metrics: at age 11, he was at age 10 he was first category, so that would be equivalent to about an expert, and at age 11 he was a candidate master, which means he was about 2,000 plus in terms of strength at age 11. So certainly a strong player in his youth. And when he earned the grandmaster title, he was until that point the youngest person to be awarded the grandmaster title. That would later be eclipsed by Bobby Fischer, and it would later be eclipsed in Russia by Garry Kasparov, but still those accomplishments stuck for quite a while. Now, let's give you an idea of kind of how strong Spassky was by looking at a couple of some of his early games before he reached his peak, but definitely when he was playing really strong chess. And these are two brief and yet devastatingly sharp games. And for that, I'll turn it over to Warren.
Thanks, Lucas.
Yeah, unlike a lot of the players we've looked at so far, Spassky didn't really have like a really distinguishable style. He was really the first, you know, universal player that chess really had. Now, you could say similar things about other players, but people like Petrosian clearly had a safe streak, and people like Tal clearly had a aggressive streak. Spassky was the first one who really just played the demands of the position. Now, he did have an inkling towards sharp positions, though, and I'll show you an example of this in this game. Now, before we get started, I'm just going to mention an opening, and later you'll find out why. So, there's this old opening called the Museo Gambit. And a member of the audience is giggling. Now, it's a very fun piece sacrifice that White plays. Now, I do not know the modern theoretical evaluation here, although I think Black is doing okay, but White has very interesting chances here. Okay. Anyway, I'm just mentioning this, and so keep this kind of sacrifice in mind later, and you'll see where Spassky was inspired from. Now, going back to the actual game. So, by the way, I should also mention, McKennis was a much, I don't know if I'm pronouncing his name correctly. Is that how you say it, Lewis?
I would think so.
Okay, yeah, McKennis. He was much older than Spassky. I don't remember his age exactly, but I think he was in his 40s, 50s.
Yeah, he played against Aliyakin, yeah. He played against Capablanca. He'd been around a while.
Yeah, he was a very experienced player, and he kind of hoped to catch Spassky unawares here. Although, turns out that Spassky was one who caught him in an opening trap, kind of. We'll see what I'm talking about here. So this is called the Alban Counter Gambit. Some of you may have seen this opening. It doesn't have the best theoretical reputation, although it is quite playable. Like Alexander Morozevich is a modern-day grandmaster who's essayed this in modern-day practice. But Spassky plays this very aggressive move, e4. So it's really double-edged, because he gives Black this protected passed pawn on d4. So it's a very dedicated move. Now, what White's trying to do is build up a big center with moves like f4, knight f3, bishop d3, and just keep a really safe center. Of course, like I said, it is positionally risky because you leave black with that advanced d pawn. So knight c6, and then f4. Now white's position is in the center is pretty strong, so black tries to undermine it with g5. Now this is not really the correct way to undermine it. It turns out a better way of doing this is with f6. This move is a much better way, because if white takes, him, it just accelerates black's development. So this is how black should destroy it. But you know, the theory of this gambit was not exactly well developed back then. And by the way, McInnes did not know that Spassky had an exact game like this 4 years ago and had a similarly good result. By the way, I just passed over this move, f5. This is actually a pretty awesome move. Now, it may look counterintuitive because with one move, black gives the black knight this excellent outpost on e5 and just drops the pawn too. But the point is that it accomplishes something else. So what does this move do for white that's good?
Blocks their bishop in.
Exactly. This bishop is going to be hard to find at a good place for. And that's going to make it hard for this rook to develop. So it's going to be hard for black to develop his pieces here. So it turns out this move is very, very strong.
Check.
Now this move, black is trying to indirectly defend g5 by making white block on d2. Now this move is a mistake. Now the best move would probably have been to take on f3. Something like
check.
Takes, queen takes, and perhaps queen e7. At least now black has hopes of playing bishop d7 and then castling queenside. This would have been a better idea. It's probably about equal. But what he didn't realize was that white had a fun idea here. Now he thought white's position was pretty difficult because if white plays knight g1, then black just plays knight e5. And this is pretty easy to play for black. White's pieces are undeveloped, and you have a great post for your knight in the center. But of course, as I told you in the Museo Gambit, you can probably guess what white played here. Yeah, he just castled. Now, I think McInnes was probably unnerved because Spassky just played these moves just instantly. Turns out, like I said, he had this exact game against somebody 4 years ago, so he was familiar with this. Of course, black takes the piece, but white has tremendous compensation here. For the piece, white has this really powerful idea of playing e5, maybe e6, and black remains with this weak king in the center, and this difficulty in developing the queenside. White has pretty good compensation. Now black tries to stop e5, but regardless, it comes anyway. White just undermines e5. This move is pretty clever. Now black cannot take because
check.
We end up in this bad situation. Now it's a fork on the bishop and king, and then black plays back, and white
check.
Can check. Now king d7 loses to rook d5,
check.
Bishop b5,
check.
And now if c6, bishop f4.
Oh, wow.
Pins everywhere. Pin cities, I've heard it referred to. Now if black ventures to the king side instead, then white has bishop c4, threatening mate in f7. And if queen e8, white can finish the game off in a nice manner.
Bishop h6.
Yeah, bishop h6.
You're picking the less beautiful one.
Oh.
I'm sorry, it's not aesthetically pleasing.
Yes, yes. Bishop h6 is exclaim question mark. Queen h6, however, is double exclaim, right?
Checkmate.
So black did not he decided not to go for this. So he just blocked on e7 with the bishop. And black still has this really annoying check on h5 to deal with, so knight f6. White just continues development, threatening bishop f6 here. White gets king out of the center, but now all of white's pieces are just fully mobilized. The absence of these pieces on the queen side is really felt here. Now here he sacrifices a piece. Now, if you think about this position for white for a moment, you have to exercise a little bit of self-control. Because white has one move that just looks absolutely crushing.
The squish pin. Queen fork of the king.
The queen fork?
No, the bishop's not. Bishop's hanging. Well, it looks like you want to take the bishop with the rook.
I was thinking of taking the knight.
Oh, on f6?
Can't take the bishop, right? With the rook.
Can't take the bishop.
With the rook?
Yeah.
You can. But I'm saying white has a very tempting move here.
Oh, I thought that was
the tempting move.
Oh, no. Sorry, I thought that was the...
Rook e8?
Yeah. Rook e8 is a very tempting move, with the point that if rook takes e8, white has this fun little
checkmate.
Right? But black has a nice saving move. He can play queen d6. Now white can continue the fireworks with queen f7. And here he's threatening, bishop takes f6, right? Devastating. But black has the saving grace, knight g8, and he gets out of it. Now Spassky saw all of this. It's pretty clever. But many, many masters such as myself might fall for this kind of trick, because they would not see this cool defense, knight g8. So that's just an interesting variation. But of course, he's Spassky. He plays the cool-headed rook takes c5. Now from here, it's just black's just suffering, basically. And bishop c6 blunders a piece, but his position was already difficult. You play a move like queen b6, and then white just plays rook d5, and this is not at all fun for black. White's gonna trade on b6, take on d4, play rook e7. This is lots of fun. But bishop c6, and now just rook e4, and black loses the knight. So here he just resigned. So yeah, a very short game, and McKennis thought that he was the experienced one that would know the opening better, when it turned out that Spassky was the one who had played the same exact game 4 years ago that McKennis didn't know about. So even from a young age, Spassky was an old man as a chess player. He already had quite a bit of experience. So that's just a little taste of his sharp side. Now here's a fun game with Bronstein. Now this was played in the USSR Championship, and after the very first move that Bronstein made, apparently he immediately regretted it, because he remembered that Spassky likes to play the King's Gambit. Now Bronstein, if you know a little bit about him, he was a very swashbuckling kind of player. He loved attacking. So he hated, of course, defending against anything like that. So when Spassky played f4, his heart just sank, basically. He had these nightmares during the whole game, apparently, that Spassky was going to play brilliancy against him. And, oddly enough, he was kind of right. So he decides to play a safe variation, just playing d5 and bishop d6. It's pretty old... It's just a safe way of giving back the pawn and developing your pieces. It's okay, but white generally has the easier play in this kind of position. So this is all pretty normal. I don't know how many games had been in this position, but several games with Anderson from the old days had been in this position as black. And here's where Bronstein kind of went astray. Played h6. It's kind of passive here. And one of the problems with this move is that it really weakens these light squares around the king. And right now it may not seem significant, but these weaknesses are going to haunt black later. Now a better idea would have just been a move like knight f6, trying to get back this d5 pawn. So this was much more precise. H6 might still be okay, but it's very risky. 94. This is a very strong move. Frees the path for this white c pawn, and that's going to make black star squared bishop uncomfortable. And now c5, forcing this black bishop to go to a passive position. You don't want to play bishop f4 because it's just g3. And now bishop c2. You can probably tell what white's preparing for, right? White wants to play queen d3 and then checkmate black. He's not playing very subtle chess, exactly. The purpose of his moves is pretty easy to understand. Much different than like Petrosian, who we studied before. Now, yes, rook e8 is fine. And here's where Bronstein kind of lost his nerve here. So of course, when your opponent plays a move like that, then you gotta be worried about checkmate a little bit, right? Now, what he should have done was immediately address the threat, which is knight f8.
Yeah.
Now he doesn't have to worry about white making any discoveries with this knight. You know, if he plays a move like knight f6, you can just take it. His h7 is defended. And then he can follow it up by guarding the light squares and moves like bishop e6, maybe c6. And black's doing somewhat okay. You know, for example, like knight e5, he can just play bishop e6. And black's position is playable here. But he wanted to try to deflect white's queen from d3. But of course, Spassky had other ideas. He played knight d6. Of course, his idea is queen h7 followed by queen h8 mate. This is the immediate threat. Now, this doesn't turn out to be entirely sound. Black can actually defend pretty well here. He did not find this defense during the game. But do you guys want to try finding the correct defense?
Pawn takes rook.
Pawn takes rook.
Start.
See, I think.
Check. That's played later.
You know, I'm kind of curious. Now, Kasparov gives the correct line, but he does not take the rook right away. I'm trying to figure out why.
Yeah,
check.
Unless that rook comes in handy later. And then you can start. Kasparov's line.
You know, it should be okay. Yeah, okay. And then after white takes the rook back, then how do you continue?
Move the knight to f8, f8, or f6.
So if you play knight f6, then what's going on here? Knight e5 followed by rook f6 looks like fun. I don't know if this works. You know, I imagine that knight takes f7 is probably strongest here. You know, for example, if king takes knight e5.
Check.
Yeah.
This looks very dangerous.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, after king g8, well, rook takes f6 looks pretty terrifying.
Why would you go to g8? Why would you go to f8?
Well, if you go to f8, I think, queen g6, queen h7.
Are you threatening mate?
Well, bishop b3 looks pretty strong with the threat of knight g6 mate. Yeah, I don't really see. I don't see an easy way to stop that, actually.
No.
Huh. Yeah, I don't see a way to stop that. Now, if he plays moves like king e6, then you just check. And then black's getting mated over here. So one good defensive method is just getting rid of the pieces that are next to your king.
Right. Just trying to decide what to take the knight with.
Well, you can't take with the c pawn because it's checkmate.
So bishop.
Oh, you take with
bishop takes knight.
Yeah.
Then you have
an
accident.
Exactly.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. This is what Spassky kind of underestimated here. Okay. Now the idea is that after queen h7,
check.
King f8, say. I think queen h8, is that correct? Yes.
Check.
Then you go up.
Check.
Black has, or sorry, black has 95 here.
Check.
But black retains pretty good compensation here. White only has decent compensation for the exchange, but nothing more really. Surprisingly, black's actually doing fine here.
Much better development.
Yeah, now black is one in the driver's seat. Say d takes e5, he can play check, and then he can actually get his pieces into play.
Check.
So this is very unclear. But Bronstein was too obsessed with trying to stop Spassky from playing a brilliancy, so he figured something so simple couldn't happen. Let's see. Okay. So he plays knight f8 with the most direct-looking move because it defends h7, right? But white just plays knight takes f7, destroying one more defender in black's position. Now black is really having problems on these light squares here, like I foreshadowed earlier.
Check.
And despite being a rook down, white's attack is just really powerful. And that move is kind of hard to play as black, because you're almost just committing Harry Carey like there. But if king takes f7, had his white finish. Yeah, knight g5 probably is also good enough. I don't remember why this was not suggested.
Bishop.
I think knight g5
check.
Is just less clear. I'm not entirely sure what happens here.
Oh, right, that's not me.
Now, one of the nice things about knight e5.
Check.
In this position,
check.
We have the same theme as earlier.
Right.
This mate's pretty hard to stop. And knight g5 might also win. I heard Peter say bishop check. So I think he was referring
check.
To this.
Check.
Bishop.
Yeah, this should also win. I guess it's just not direct mate. I mean, white wins the queen.
Wait.
Check.
Couldn't you mate on it? Oh no, knight covers h7. So. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's a much simpler. So if king
check.
h8, then just rook f8's mate.
Check.
Yeah, so you were right. Yeah. Okay, so yeah, knight g5 also looks winning. Okay. So yeah, knight f7 is immune, unfortunately, so that's why he resorted to this bishop f5 move. White's pieces just gather around the black king. And actually coming up is an interesting moment here. So here white plays
check.
The crushing queen e4.
Yeah.
Now, Lucas, did you want to mention the...
I'll talk about it after.
Okay, yeah. So at this point, black's just dead lost. If king h8, then rook f8 is just
check.
Decisive.
Yeah.
Right? And if g6 had his white win, or sorry, g6 here had his white win. There's more than one road to Rome here, so.
Rook f7.
Yeah, rook f7 is probably pretty
check.
Simple. Queen takes, bishop takes, followed by taking on g6, right? Yeah, that's pretty simple. No, I wouldn't doubt it if rook takes f8 also wins, but it's probably more complicated. You know, for example, rook f8.
Check.
Whoops.
Check.
Something like bishop f7. Well, I guess this doesn't quite work, huh? Yeah. Okay, so we'll stick with rook f7. I think that's probably simplest. Yeah. Okay, so I said Spassky was a universal player, and then I show you these games where he just has his swashbuckling attacks. You'll just have to trust me. These are good examples of what he'd like to be as a chess player. But of course, if he had to play a calm Ruy Lopez position, he could definitely play that very well. And we'll see a later position where it's not quite so sharp later on. So, does anybody have any questions about those two games?
When were they?
Oh, so
1661, I think.
Yeah, so this Bronstein-Spassky game was in 1960, and the previous McKenna's game was in 1959. Yeah. Yeah. They were both in the USSR championships.
Spassky was like 22, 23.
In 1960, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. But by the way, despite his strong performance in these games, he did not yet win the USSR championship, despite being a very strong player. And I'll mention that later too. All right.
That's a tough competition.
Yeah. Yeah.
I can't really blame him.
Okay, so we saw the King's Gambit there, and that was actually an opening that Spassky had played in his career. He played about 50 times, and I don't have the exact number, but the book says about 50 times, and apparently he never lost with it. He had wins or draws all through his career with the King's Gambit. Now, the King's Gambit fell out of favor somewhat because in 1960 in Argentina, Spassky beat a young Bobby Fischer with the King's Gambit, and Fischer was pretty upset by this, and he spent many, many months analyzing. And then he published his article, A Bust to the King's Gambit, which greatly reduced the number of people who are still playing the King's Gambit, but that didn't deter Spassky. Spassky still enjoyed playing it. And Kasparov was once asked whether, and I'll quote here, it says in the book, I once asked Garry Kasparov whether Spassky's record could be seen as an endorsement of the opening. No, Kasparov said, it's an endorsement of Spassky. The King's Gambit is rubbish. Spassky was so strong that he could succeed even after handicapping himself with a dubious opening. Now, Kasparov benefited from computer analysis and many, many more years of analysis in the intervening years between 1960 and the 1980s, but still, Spassky was able to do quite good things with the King's Gambit, and that wasn't the only gambit he played. There were other gambits and attacks that he enjoyed playing. He had a fairly large repertoire. You'd never know going against Spassky if he was going to open e4, d4, c4. He could open with all of them, and would, as the situation called for. He was adaptable. We'll see some more about that later. Also, the game with Bronstein actually inspired this scene from Russia with Love, the James Bond movie that came out in 1962 or 63, I think. And in it, the villain, Kronstein, is playing against a Canadian grandmaster or something named McAdams, supposedly, in the film narrative, and crushes him with the move Spassky played, essentially. So this game became somewhat widely known and became somewhat celebrated. And as Warren mentioned, Bronstein regretted immediately playing the King's Gambit or allowing the King's Gambit to happen against someone who loved it as much as Spassky did. So anyway, Spassky didn't get to the top by himself. He had some help. His first coach was a guy named by the name of Vladimir Zak, who was fairly well known. He not only coached Spassky, he also coached Korshnoi. That's a tongue twister. And he was an author of books. And he coached Spassky from the age of 10 in 1947 until about 1952. In 1952, Spassky had, I don't want to say he outgrew Zak, but his playing ability certainly was far stronger than his, and he then approached Alexander Talouche to coach him. Now, we saw Talouche in a match against Tall in the Tall lecture, and Talouche was a strong player in his own right. Here in 1950, he finished fourth in the USSR championship, and finished ahead of Smyslov, for example, and Geller, and Floor, and McInnes, who we just saw, so and Petrosian. So he was a very strong player in his own right. And Spassky benefited from his tutelage. Now, Talouche was known as kind of an attacking player. And he would kind of psych himself up before games, you know, Touche would, and sometimes he'd make a move over the board and he'd say the equivalent in Russian of charge, you know, like full speed ahead sort of thing. And the chess players would all joke about this. There's stories of Spassky and Korchnoi and other players getting sentimental about Touche, you know, even 30, 40 years later, and his style. They would say, oh, well, Touche would have played this in this situation. And Botvinnik once chastised a young Garry Kasparov, saying that he played like Touche, you know. He played a very risky attacking game, you know, without much grace. And so, but this certainly helped a young Spassky develop his attacking repertoire. And we have Touche to thank for that. And he wasn't Spassky's last coach. In fact, they had a falling out in 1961, and that marked the end of their collaboration. Now, Spassky's first USSR championship was played in 1955, and in his first tournament, he did quite well. He finished tied for third, or he finished fourth, if you will, on tie breaks against a very, very strong field. And there you see him all sitting around a table, you know, with a young Spassky. Now, Spassky was a reserved, quiet guy. When he first started playing chess at the Young Pioneers Palace, he preferred to just watch and listen. You know, he would play, but he wanted to absorb it all in. And I think we even see that reflected in our 18-year-old iteration of Spassky. I think surrounded by a table of distinguished players, and with the only one close to him in age being Petrosian, you know, I think that he would have been content to sit back and listen and soak in knowledge. But there you have a strong performance, tying essentially Petrosian and Botvinnik, and doing better than Taimanov and Karas and other really strong players in his first USSR championship. And so he was a guy to really look out for, and everybody knew it. The question was he going to continue with his work ethic, and was he going to keep improving beyond the ability of his coaches to assist with? And the answer is yes. In 1961, he won his first USSR championship. And again, if you look at the field, you know, you've got Tal in there, you've got Smyslov, that's two world champions right there in that field. Botvinnik didn't play, Petrosian didn't play, but you've got a very strong field there, and he only had one loss in the whole tournament. So he had reached the top. Now, this came after some turbulent years. He had ended his career, or he'd ended his relationship with Touche. He'd also ended his first marriage, which wasn't a happy one, in 1960. And after he kind of broke out of that, he also broke out of a funk that he was in and then progressed. It was kind of like he plateaued and then he broke through to keep improving. So you know that Spassky was a candidate for the world championship against Petrosian in 1966. This is the road that he took to get there. And what's really remarkable about this journey is he played a different style against every opponent. Against Karas, he was cautious, he was very strategic, he was very long-term thinking. Against Geller, he went for mating attacks. And against Tal, he played very, very quiet and played the counterattacking style. He let Tal come to him and impale himself on Spassky's sword, if you want to think of it that way. And that approach, varying up your style for different opponents, was different than what most people played. A, Tal would attack anybody, you know. Mm-hmm. He would, except maybe Korchnoi, because he was kind of afraid of Korchnoi. And other players would kind of have a similar style in all through their games, but Spassky could vary it up. This is what Warren was saying with that universal style. He could adapt his strategy to his opponent, which made him very strong in these kind of bracketed knockout tournaments. He did extremely well. as we'll see in other brackets in the future. So he was able, he then earned the right to play Petrosian, and we know from the Petrosian lecture that the first match was very narrowly decided in favor of the reigning world champion, and this constituted the first successful title defense since the 1920s with Aliekhin against the name is escaping, Bogolyubov. But it was close, and Spassky learned a lot from this match. You know, it was characterized by mostly draws. You see, I think Petrosian won 4, Spassky 3, and the remaining 17 matches were drawn. But Spassky learned a lot from it, and he came out of it with renewed focus. And so he, as the runner-up to the world champion, he again was seeded directly into the candidates tournament, directly into the brackets, and he had a very similar journey. He played Geller this time in the first round, and he played again an attacking style and was able to prevail quite easily. Played Bent Larsen in the second round, and again won. If you win by a 3-game margin in match play with these short of matches, that's pretty huge. So he had no trouble moving through Geller, moving through Larsen, moving through Korchnoi, and everybody realized this was kind of a sea change. They realized that Spassky was probably the strongest player in the world right now, and therefore he was favored somewhat in the World Championship match. And as we know, again, from the Petrosian lecture, this time Spassky showed his maturity and it showed his strength by winning. It's not a landslide, you know, he didn't crush Petrosian. But he won convincingly with a 2-game margin there. So Spassky at this point is the strongest player in the world, and everybody knows that the second strongest player in the world is probably, in fact, Fischer, with Petrosian and Tal and a couple of others being rounding out the top 5. So he is the uncontested champion, but his reign would only last one cycle. Now, before we get to that world championship where he tried to defend, let's again look at another game from kind of the peak of his, well, not the peak, but I guess the beginning of the strong point of his career, and this is against Paul Ugayevsky. Was this from the USSR championship as well?
Yeah, I think it was.
Okay.
Yeah, was that the cross table from the 1961 USSR Championship?
Yes.
Okay. I had the memory that this Paul Ugayevsky game was from that USSR Championship. Yeah, this game was kind of a tragedy for Spassky because, you know, I thought it was in the USSR Championship.
Yeah, Paul Ugayevsky finished second in that championship, and it looks like... It looks like he, no, did he didn't look like he took a game off of Spassky there.
Okay, let me look at the...
It may have been from a different tournament.
Okay, yeah. So I'll have to look up at what tournament this was in, but this was a very devastating loss for Spassky. He played a great game. He just lost his nerve in the important moment of it. But, you know, this game was also interesting, so... It shows his inkling towards attacking again, but he was also kind of an idealistic player, and he purposely avoided simpler wins, pretty much. So I'll show you what I'm talking about here. So again, Paul Ugayevsky tried to play psychological duels with Spassky, and that also didn't work out in his favor very well. So he tried to just play simple chess and tried to trade off some pieces early on in the opening. So he plays his early move knight e4, which is not a particularly a good idea. It just wastes time, basically. This move is very good. Now, it may look like not such a good idea because of Black's reply.
Check.
Bishop b4. Now, it looks kind of annoying because you can't play knight d2 because you just lose your bishop. So you have to move your king. But if you look at the result, Black spent a tempo moving this bishop to b4, which, after White moves the king, is absolutely useless. And he's going to have to move it again, so it's essentially 2 wasted tempi. Meanwhile, White's king just gets moved to the center, which is closed. So this is not really a handicap for White. Just king f1. But Spassky mentions that king e2 is also strong.
Okay.
So they're both equally viable. his idea was he wanted to be able to take on f3 with a queen if black decided to take.
Check.
Now, of course, white is attacking on the king side. White has all these pieces pointed over there. And now a move like knight g5 is kind of unpleasant. So black decides to counter white's threat before it even happens by playing f5. And now, as Kasparov writes, you know, white plays a third king move, or sorry, white plays another king move, and his initiative just grows. Because, of course, he's going to play moves like g4, rook g1, and he's just going to start attacking black, and this ends up happening. g4 right away, because if takes, then knight g5 is just really strong. You know, black does not want to take and open up this h-file. But there's no other way to defend the threats to e6 and h7. So taking the pawn is way too risky. So now all of white's pieces are beautifully placed. You can just really tell Spassky had a good feel for the harmony of his pieces here. Kind of reminds you of Smyslov in a position like this. Even though he's attacking, he just establishes really nice harmony. Now here he finds another nice move. So if you were to play a move like rook g2, then black actually gets decent counterplay with knight h5. And black plugs up this h-file, which is pretty useful. So Spassky plays what might look kind of weird, rook g5. Just looks bizarre because you're lining up your rook with that bishop. But the point is that it stops black's knight from hopping to h5 and halting that h-pawn. So it's very clever. Finally, white is able to advance this guy. Now, b5 may look odd, but black is just trying to open up the queen side here. His idea is after c takes, he can play rook b8. And a4, say a6. Try to make this king feel a little bit uncomfortable. Get some counterplay over there. But Spassky is having none of this. He played c5. He's going to keep this closed. Now, it is a pawn sacrifice, but if black takes, then white gets this juicy 5 square. Now, black should not have allowed white to get this. He should have played a move like rook d8, play a little bit more calmly. Instead, he took on c5, which is extremely risky because of what I said about the e5 square. It's too much to give white that. White's just gaining up on g7. Continuing to look pretty ominous. Now white was threatening e4, so black gave his queen a spot to go check if white were to do that. So b3, just stopping the threat. Now again, black's giving himself a space to go with his queen.
Check.
Now, where do you go with your king here? You only have two choices, right? You can go back or you can go forward.
E3. D1.
Oh, sorry, you have four choices. The three choices, yeah. You go to D1, E1, or E3. Now, if you go to D1, then just queen
check.
D3, right? And if you go to E1, I think the same move is probably... Oh, wait. Queen D3 looks rather bad. If king E1...
Push the pawn.
Yeah, D1's pushed.
C2.
Oh. Well. No, I should have analyzed this. I didn't even consider moving the king back, actually. Well, C2, king D2 looks fine for white. Well, this may also be strong, actually. But of course, he goes up. The king's actually pretty safe there. He makes a pretty bold march later. It could have turned out a lot better than it did. Now here, white has a pretty simple win that he passed up basically on purpose now. He can play just e5, and if rook g6, queen h5, and black's just toast here. You know, if rook g2,
check.
White queens,
checkmate.
And there's just nothing you can do. But he wanted to create something that was pretty, so he decided to go for rook takes h7. Of course, he's threatening rook h8, And if black takes, then white just queens. So
check.
Black doesn't have much choice but to try to check white as much as possible. Now here, queen takes is not
check.
To be suggested. White has to sacrifice the rook, and then he loses the other one. So the only choice is king takes.
Check.
And now white's king has to march forward.
Check.
Oh, yes. Is this the critical moment? Check.
Yeah.
G5.
Double question mark.
Yes, yes. King H5 is a tragedy here. He didn't see that black had one more check. Now white has a chance to play a pretty amazing move here. Kasparov gives a really long speech about how great it would have been if he had found this move.
Yeah.
Just go forward. Turns out the king is pretty safe on the king's side.
The rook,
queen takes, just king f7.
Yeah.
And black can't prevent mate over here. Queening, queen h5, it's too many threats going on. Spassky missed a chance for this. It's really tragic. And this would have been made for a pretty amazing game.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not very often. Kasparov says it a lot better than I do. He says about a hail of bullets,
yeah,
running your king down across enemy lines.
He says this would have been one of Spassky's best wins. Such bold raids by the king under a hail of bullets can be counted on the fingers of one hand and are part of the golden treasury of chess. Alas.
Yeah, he makes it sound pretty epic. If I was Spassky, I think I would cry if I read those words.
Oh, he's still alive.
Yeah. I hope he didn't read that book. But yeah, he missed this, unfortunately. Instead, he played king h5.
Check.
And he missed this check over here.
Yeah.
Really tragic.
Check.
And now, black finds the brilliant queen g5. Now, black ends up trading, and white just has nothing left. Now, this rook endgame is so bad because of this protected passed pawn on c3. This g pawn is going nowhere. Polk IFC cleans up pretty nicely. And then from here, there's not really much looking at. They end
check.
Up trading down to this, and white resigned. You know, say king e6, black just takes on a3 and marches. Yeah, so that game was, it was a great game by Spassky, but that game kind of broke him. You know, for a while, I don't think he even played any tournaments. He took a pretty long hiatus.
That was actually toward the end of his marriage and his relationship with Toulouse as well. Yeah.
Oh, really?
Okay. Yeah, it was a trifecta.
They come in threes.
Wow.
It was a perfect storm of fail. Yeah.
Yeah, so the early 1960s were a very rough time for Spassky. It wasn't until 1968 that he fully recovered and beat Petrosian. But he was probably near the top of the world that time anyway. So, just really bad life circumstances. Does anybody have any questions about that game?
How many exclamation marks would King F6 get?
Oh,
two.
Yeah.
Just two.
Kasparov gives it two.
Yeah. I mean, going back to that position, you know, because if you play King E3, King F4, King G5, you know, if you're that bold in the first place, I'm not sure you can afford it too many.
Check.
I mean, it is pretty stunning to be able to move your king that close down to the other side of the board. I'd give it 1.5.
Why is the rook check? Oh, no, because
pawn
takes out.
Yeah.
Genius is terrible.
That's
a disaster.
Yeah. And then mate.
Yeah.
This would have been beautiful.
Yeah.
Having a hard time closing the window, but I'll pass it back to you, Lucas.
Okay, so we know about the 1972 World Championship, and I'm not going to go into great detail about this. That's That's the subject of a whole other lecture, likely. But there's a couple of things I want you to know about Spassky and about his preparation. First, from about 1970 on, after he wins the world championship, I don't want to say he was complacent. I don't want to say he was lazy. I can't really level those kind of accusations. But he didn't play many tournaments. And he was in really good shape. Spassky was an athletic guy. If you don't know, Spassky took pride in the fact that he was a pretty good tennis player. He shared that in common with Fischer, actually, although they never played each other, to my knowledge. And he also, maybe not in his 30s, but when he was younger, he was able to high jump his own height. So he could high jump himself, if you will. And so he was in really good shape. You know, he exercised a lot. It's one thing Botvinnik really admired about him. And so he came in the match in good physical shape, but he came into the match under a lot of stress. That stress not only came from the fact that he hadn't played much, and so he wasn't necessarily in his top form. It also came from the knowledge that Fischer was considered by almost everybody to be a favorite, to be the strongest chess player in the world. Much like Spassky was when he was on his rise to take down Petrosian. There's also remember, Fischer came into this match on a 20-match win streak. Like, he won 20 straight matches. He rolled over, he 6-0'd Taimanov, and then he 6-0'd Bent Larsen. I guess is when he played Petrosian that he's on a 20-match win streak. Petrosian actually gave him a run for his money before Fischer won 4 straight matches against Petrosian, which had never been done. And so Fischer came into the match with a lot of confidence. Spassky was somewhat nervous, not just because of Fischer's strength, but also because of all the pressure he was under from the Central Committee of the Soviet Communist Party. They had surrounded him with minders, if you will. One, for example, his second was Geller, which made a ton of sense because Geller had a positive record against Fischer and was a strong grandmaster in his own right. But they also surrounded him with minders, including KGB agents, for a number of reasons. Number one, they wanted to make sure that he was focused in his entirety on the match and that he won because the Russian ideology had to prevail. Also, because they were somewhat concerned that he might defect, that he might flee, that he might try to renounce his Soviet citizenship and demand asylum. They were somewhat concerned about that. And also, they were concerned that he might lose. And so, this, for all these reasons, they subjected him to a ton of pressure. And on the other side, Fischer was doing some really silly maneuvering stuff that we'll talk about another day, but that really wasn't helping out. Like, he was refusing to play, and then he was, you know, not there at the opening ceremony when they had to draw, you know, who would start with what color. He just didn't show up. He was sleeping. Second match, Fischer didn't even show up. He just forfeited it, and this kind of unnerved Spassky somewhat. So Spassky, pretty cheerful, calm guy, but he's under a lot of pressure here from a lot of different angles. And Fischer took this match fairly easily. Spassky started with a 2-0 lead because he won the first match, and then the second match he won by forfeit. But he ended up losing by like 3 or 4 points. It was pretty one-sided. So he went back to the Soviet Union and is somewhat disgraced, and yet he was still the strongest player in the Soviet delegation. In the 1973 USSR Championship, he won, much to the chagrin of the Communist Central Committee. They were kind of in their post-Spassky era, and they wanted their new golden boy, Karpov, to take the reins of Soviet chess. And that didn't happen, at least not immediately. And so that was somewhat disappointing, I suppose, for the authorities, that Spassky was still the strongest player and he was still their guy, and they thought he had little to no chance of defeating Fischer in a rematch. They thought he was damaged goods, that his era was over and it was time to move along to the future. And same thing with Petrosian. They thought his star had burned out and it was time to look on, and that was either Korchnoi or Karpov. Although Korchnoi they weren't sure about because he wasn't towing the party line very well. But Karpov, he was a golden boy. So, but he won. He won his second USSR championship. He had tied for a third, but this was the second one that he had won outright. And so he's still quite strong, but he's having major doubts about his citizenship in Russia, his participation for Soviet chess, life in general. Now, there's a couple things I have to explain. First, if you won a lot of money in a tournament, you got to keep only a fraction of it. The rest went to the state, went to the Central Committee, went to authorities in the Chess Federation, etc., etc. So if Spassky played, when Spassky played in the World Championship in 1972, the prize pool was $250,000. He won 3/8 of that as the loser. And I don't know exactly how much the government let him keep, but it would have been a fraction of that. I mean, at most, you know, he won, let's say, I guess, mental math. If he won on the order of $70,000-$80,000, he may have got to keep 1,000 or 2,000 of it. The rest would have just been taken by the state. And this was true also when he went to play in tournaments in, you know, the U.S. or in the Netherlands or wherever he went and played. He had to pay off, you know, the prize money wouldn't even go directly to him. It'd go to the Chess Federation, and then they'd decide how much he got. So that was problematic. That created friction. Second, he was not a member of the Communist Party. You may remember from my lecture on the Soviet School of Chess that not everybody in the Soviet Union was a member of the Communist Party. In fact, it was a small fraction of the population that were actually members of the Communist Party, and Spassky was not one of them. In fact, he liked to make fun of party officials and Lenin, and you know, he'd do impersonations of them and you know, make them sound like buffoons. The problem is he would do this in front of party officials. So he wasn't as openly rebellious as Korchnoi, but he certainly made his opinion known that he was not a happy camper. And this was accentuated in 1975 when he started dating who would become his future wife, Marina Spassky, his third wife, in fact, started dating a woman who worked in the French embassy in Moscow, a woman whose grandfather had been a general in Russia during the revolution and had fled, because if he wouldn't have, he would have been executed, who had fled and immigrated to France, and then his granddaughter, who was a staunch anti-communist, got a job working in the embassy in Moscow to kind of undo it from within, if you will. And the KGB had an extensive file on her. They knew who her grandfather was. And they knew when Spassky and her started seeing each other, and they were extremely concerned about this. She was not a person to be trusted, you know, per the KGB, and they undertook some actions to try to prevent the relationship. The first thing they did is they called all of their chess player informants / agents, like Petrosian. Petrosian was a KGB agent starting in 1973. They called them and they said, hey, you've got to dissuade Spassky from pursuing this relationship. And so a lot of the other chess players who were his quote-unquote friends started saying, hey, you know, she's not good for you. You got to break this off with her. This isn't good. That was the first tactic, to try to undermine the relationship from within. That didn't work. So the next thing they did is the KGB went to a public health office where they treated STDs, and they obtained some pubic lice from a sample that from a woman who had contracted venereal disease. So they took these pubic lice, they broke into Marina's apartment, and they put these pubic lice on her undergarments. thinking that she would get infected with venereal disease, and then that Spassky would catch venereal disease from her, and then Spassky would realize, oh wow, she's a, I don't know, a prostitute or whatever, and would break it off. Well, she laundered her garments or something, I don't know, but the infection didn't happen. And in fact, the KGB agent who did this got a special citation because he was really worried that he was going to get infected while he was spreading these, and that his wife was going to ask him, where the heck did you get a venereal disease? So Andropov, who was the director of the KGB, actually gave him a special citation for his effort. Well, that didn't work. So the next thing they did is they went back to that clinic and they got pubic lice from a woman who was infected with gonorrhea. Okay, now we're taking it up a notch. Gonorrhea, as you may know, is a much more serious STD than venereal disease, and they did the same thing, broke back into her apartment. They had it under surveillance. They knew when she was not home and when her neighbors were not home and when they could get in and out without being noticed. Same agent went in with the same little glass vials and spread pubic lice with gonorrhea on her undergarments. Creepy. That didn't take either.
Wow.
So they unsuccessfully tried to infect her with STDs twice, and after that, she went back to France, and Boris maneuvered so that he could follow her. Now, it's not a clear-cut defection in the sense of Korchnoi. Korchnoi defected earlier in 1976. Korchnoi had played in a tournament, and we'll talk about it in a Korchnoi lecture, but Korchnoi had played in a tournament in the Netherlands, and after he finished his last round match, which he won, he asked his opponent how to spell political asylum, and then he wrote out a note, you know, saying he demanded political asylum, and he presented it to authorities, and he was offered political asylum, and he officially defected. And this was after the Soviet Union had kept him under lock and key in the Soviet Union for about 3 years to keep him from defecting. Once he first international tournament, he went out and won it, and then he defected. And this was, and Spassky was soon to follow. And the KGB wanted to do the same thing with Spassky. They wanted to keep him in Russia, but they didn't have the same leverage. See, Korchnoi, they had his wife and his son. Remember what I told you about Tal? Whenever he'd travel internationally, his wife and kid and daughter would have to stay in the Soviet Union as leverage against defection. Well, Korchnoi left without his family. Spassky didn't have a family, so they didn't have that same leverage over him. And they also didn't want to cause an international scandal by denying him the ability to follow the woman he loved. And there was also a West German industrialist who had aided Spassky, and there was some money involved and maybe some bribes involved too. And for all of those reasons, I guess, Spassky was able to maneuver himself out of the Soviet Union, and he moved to France with Marina. And they lived there for, you know, 30-some-odd years after that together in a little quiet suburb of Paris. Spassky became a French citizen in 1978. He would continue to play under the Soviet flag until about 1982, and then he changed to play under the French flag. So now we'll look at our third game, which is from this era, in which you can see that Spassky, even 10 years post World Championship, is still in very strong chess shape. So, right there, yeah.
Oh, nice. Fancy. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was just looking at the Kasparov book, and in this game against Paul Gajewski, supposedly was from the 1961 USSR Championship.
Okay.
Apparently the loss cost of that, so I'll be curious if that cross table was actually from 61 or from 60 or something. But I'll have to look at that later. Anyway, to the short game. Now here I just took a position from this game. Now you might be able to tell, or maybe you won't, but this pawn structure arose from a French winnower, or winnower, however you pronounce that opening's name. I'm not sure.
Winnower is how I've always heard it.
Yeah. And you know, this characteristic pawn structure of doubled C pawns, pawns in D4 and E5. That's a pretty closed position. And Spassky found a really strong move here, and I think it's really characteristic of how he approached chess. So he was always kind of concrete. He would play moves that normally you would think of as anti-positional or not very strong, but he had a very specific concrete idea or threat. And here was a pretty similar thing. Do you want to look for the move, or should I just reveal?
Whose move is it?
It's white to play, I should mention.
Check.
Yeah.
Yeah. Whoops. Sorry. I already gave it away. Yeah.
Knight to F10.
Oops. Sorry, guys.
Check.
Yeah. So this position is often given in chess books as a great example of when to trade two rooks for a queen. And normally, you don't want to trade rooks for a queen like this in a closed position, because queens operate well in big open positions, right? Where they can fork different things. And if, like, in this position, there's just one open file. So if white doesn't create anything, then black can just double rooks on that file, and white's going to have no hope of winning, right? But Spassky evaluated this very, very correctly. His idea was to actually force open the position, and it turns out black can't really stop it. So of course black must take, because otherwise he's going to take this knight.
Check.
Now he comes up with this clever maneuver. Now his idea is to go to e3. And where do you think he's going from there? Is he going to go to d1, and then b2, and then a4, and then c5?
No.
Take d5.
Well, that's one possibility, yeah.
Other possibility is to take the c4.
Yeah.
C4
yeah.
Opens up pretty good.
Yeah, taking c4 turns out to be the target he aims for. And it's pretty hard for black to stop this. He can play moves like bishop d5, but then white is going to play bishop g2 and sack on d5. Mm-hmm. So regardless, white is going to force open the position. And this is what Short failed to appreciate. I think he just didn't expect the old man Spassky to play such sharp chess here. So,
well, there's some truth to that. After a while, Spassky was pretty content to draw. Mm. You know, he'd go in and just, you know, he would just go to tournaments, get his draws, get his prize money, and go home. So it's not surprising that Short would expect, you know, that Spassky come in with that same attitude. And it was only if you really annoyed Spassky that he would actually start trying to play, as Kasparov discovered later. But
yeah, at the time too, Short was an ambitious 17-year-old. So I'm not sure how much knowledge of chess history or how much respect he had for Spassky or anything. So in any event, Spassky plays a really strong continuation.
Check.
Here. So of course he sacks on c4 like we're talking about. And it turns out that the poor coordination of these black pieces it renders him helpless against white's massive pawns and queen.
King of Solomon.
Yeah.
Yeah, despite all these pieces black has, they're all on the other side of the board. Whereas white is gonna push these pawns and attack black here.
Check.
Already these pawns creep forward. A5 is looking a little soft as well. Now he's preparing to push the d-pawn, bring the queen in here. Black finally gets a piece over, but not before white plays d5. Now, of course, this just loses because of what?
Queen b6.
Check.
Now, remember what we said earlier.
Oh.
Queen b6 is exclam question mark.
Okay. Okay. So bishop b6.
Yeah, there we go. This is the exclam, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so the d-pawn cannot be taken. So he tries to somehow coordinate his pieces, but it's pretty hard. Now he's targeting this a5 pawn.
Check. 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 Check.
Now this is a common grandmaster practice, so the idea is that you want to repeat a couple moves. Now I don't know if Aditya ever told you about this idea. Okay, so you repeat moves a couple times just to give your opponent the hint that you might be okay with a draw. And then you psychologically devastate them by declining the opportunity to do so. So you'll see this a lot in Grandmaster games. They'll have a good position, they'll just repeat moves a couple times, and then just refuse to repeat it again. Yeah.
Why the rook move down there? I mean, was that just
to be one? Well, so his idea was to stop this d-pawn from moving, because now if white moves the d-pawn, then it's checkmate.
Oh. Oh, I see the bishop. Okay.
Right. So he was trying to delay the advance of White's pawn phalanx. Unfortunately, though, White prepares the advance of this. So now he's trying to go to a5. And this is pretty annoying since queen check on c7 results in mate on d8. So Black tries to block this. Now White finally blocks this diagonal.
Yeah.
So at this point, he frees up the d-pawn. So, I mean, I really don't know what else to suggest here. Black's position is pretty difficult to play. You can't move his e-pawn. You can't really move this rook. Moving the bishop would accomplish nothing. It's already pretty hard to suggest much.
Check.
White reveals an attack on the rook and just continues to advance these kingside pawns. See, now he's threatening taking on e6, followed by bishop d8, and then taking e6 again, and with three connected passed pawns, it's going to be pretty hard to defend. So Black tries to get rid of at least something, but Spassky
check.
Finishes off nicely.
Check.
And now White is just devastating here. Now, he short could have played king c8 and prolonged the game a little bit. Of course, now White wins by... Well, what's the simplest way to win here?
To take the g7.
Yeah, that's actually simplest. Queen takes f7 also does win, but this is far simpler because after, say, rook g8, you can just play what?
Queen to f8. No. Yeah.
Yeah, queen to f8 is pretty strong,
check.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you win the rook or force Black to
check.
Just renew your queen, basically. So, yeah, and he just committed Harry Carry by going to c6.
Checkmate.
And then it's mate. See, I know. I think this game is really instructive because, like I said, it's really counterintuitive to be able to sacrifice two rooks for a queen in a closed position like that. It's very unusual because normally a queen does not operate well in that kind of position. But he saw a little bit further than Short did. He saw that he could sacrifice a piece and bust open the queen side, leaving Black no defense. So this kind of concrete approach made him pretty dangerous. We saw earlier his attacking pension in the opening, but even outside of that, he was a very dangerous player in the middle game. Does anybody have any questions about that game? Nope. Pretty obvious, right? Yeah, sorry I busted the surprise and just showed rook b6. I have a trigger finger. I'll have to work on that. All right.
Yeah, the story with Kasparov is that they played, I think the match was in 1989. And, you know, Spassky is an old veteran of, you know, he's the not necessarily the patriarch, that was Botvinnik, but, you know, he's on a pillar in Soviet chess and in worldwide chess. And Kasparov is a young player who is world champion and is in his prime, which would last a while. But they played a match, and after move 12, Spassky offered Kasparov a draw. Kasparov declined, and then made a little inaccuracy on move 13 or 14, and Spassky pounced on it and got a really strong position out of it. And on move 19, Spassky said to Kasparov, "You know, Garry Kimovich, I offer you a draw, and if you don't take it, I'm going to blow you off the board." Kasparov accepted the draw. So there was some fire left, you know, in Spassky. But anyway, in 1992, you'll know that the rematch of the century happened. The match of the century was, of course, the 1972 match between Spassky and Fischer. 1992, there was the rematch of the century. And remember, Fischer hasn't played anybody in a rated game since 1972 because he refused to play. He took his ball and went home. And finally, enough money was put up that they tempted Fischer into a rematch with Spassky, and he was surprisingly strong. Spassky at this time is still rated 106th in the world, and Fischer beat him pretty handily. Now, Garry Kasparov, who was watching the match, said, well, you know, Fischer's opening repertoire, and his theory hasn't changed at all since the 70s, and the game's kind of updated without him. And, you know, if he and I played, it wouldn't even be close. But the point was, Fischer was more than a match for Spassky and wasn't going to play anybody else. And they were kind of, it's interesting, they were, so Spassky considered his two closest friends in the chess world to be Fischer and Tal. Now, Fischer called Spassky his frenemy, and I'm not making that up. Fischer actually said frenemy 20 years before that trended on Twitter. He called Spassky his frenemy because he had a rivalry with him, but he respected him. And there's some friendships that are forged like that over the board. I'm reminded of when Kasparov was talking about Karpov, and he said, yeah, I hated him as a person, but I really respect him as a chess player. There was a time in our matches where he and I were playing, and we were the only people in the world who understood what was going on. So it's kind of like there's someone to share your genius, I guess, a foil for your genius. And so Fischer appreciated and respected Spassky, and Spassky did some stuff that surprised people. He said, well, if you're going to indict Fischer for tax fraud, then you need to put me in the jail cell with him, because I was playing. And by the way, when you put us together, just make sure we have a chessboard in pieces. And so he kind of reached out and extended that olive branch, if you will, toward Fischer. It wasn't wholeheartedly reciprocated, because Bobby at this point is pretty cynical. But the gesture was certainly there. And I was touched when I read about after Fischer died in 2008, Spassky went and visited his grave and in Iceland. And he said... He said, I see the spot next to it is available. So he said, maybe we'll see one day, you know, like and I'm paraphrasing, but the idea was that there was a solidarity there that was certainly present from Spassky's end toward Fischer, if not necessarily reciprocated. I don't know if Bobby was capable of reciprocating, but the gesture was certainly there on Spassky's part. Now, Spassky stayed fairly active in chess until about 2006. In 2006, while giving a chess lecture in San Francisco, he suffered a mild stroke. And actually, I think it was Susan Polgar who took him to the hospital. I think she was there with him at that lecture. They had had a friendship. Spassky had played a lot of the top women players in the world in the 2000s, and Susan Polgar among them, and they took him to the hospital, and he was, he recovered in short order, and then in 2009 he suffered another stroke. This one was a little more serious. His left side was paralyzed, and it required extensive therapy, which he underwent, and he recovered. And his main way of communicating and staying involved was through Skype. He would Skype a lot of old friends. He would Skype journalists. You know, he would stay in touch that way. And then in 2012, we had a very weird incident. Spassky disappears from his suburban Parisian home, and he emerges a day or two later in Moscow for the first time in, you know, what, almost 40. Well, a little 45 years, 40 some odd, 43 years. He ends up in Moscow, and the state media runs a report saying that he had been kept a prisoner in his own home, that his wife was not letting him leave and was holding him back, and his therapist wouldn't clear him for this, that, and the other, and that he was and that some brave friends of his had taken him to the embassy in. The Russian embassy in Paris, gotten him a visa to leave the country, and that he had been rescued, if you will, to be taken back to Moscow. Now, his wife issued a statement saying that he had been kidnapped. And his sister, Spassky's younger sister, issued a corroborating statement with the wife saying that, you know, his wife had taken excellent care of him, and she had nothing but good things to say about Marina, and the situation around this was and she wasn't being allowed to talk to her brother and or visit him or this, that, and the other. And so it's really unclear what the truth is around that, we really may never know, even though Spassky's still around. He still lives in Moscow. We saw that one of the very first pictures where he was a guest on a Moscow television show. To my knowledge, that was 2013. That was his last public appearance. He's not been, I couldn't find any more recent photographs than that, or any video footage more recent than that. And so and to my knowledge, he's not been reunited with his wife. His wife has not been allowed to join him in Russia, whether on his wishes or the state's wishes. And I don't know what the situation was with his sister either. So it's unclear. Maybe he was, maybe it was as they say, where, you know, or as the state media reported, where, you know, he wasn't allowed to leave and he's been liberated, or maybe now he's in need of liberation. It's really unclear, but we do know that his health is declining fairly rapidly, and that, you know, his chess career is long behind him, and I would imagine public speaking is as well. So while he still he's again, as I mentioned, he's the first world champion that we've covered who's still alive. It's tenuous at best. All right, so next month, and we're going to go back to late October, and it'll give us more time to prepare, which is good. We'll be looking at Fischer. And we've already given away, you know, a decent amount of information about Fischer in this lecture because it's inevitable. But there's quite a bit to talk about there and look at. And to close, as always, I use the following books, and most of them I have here with me. You're welcome to take a look at them, and they're all, you know, commercially available. And obviously, we're open for any questions you might have.
I have a question. So, on the slide showing the pictures from their 1992 match,
yes,
it looks like in one of the pictures, like Fischer is giving the bird to the camera.
He is indeed. Yeah, I put that in there as a little hidden gem. Just like on the title slide, I have that awesome sweater that Spassky's wearing.
I thought that at first, but then I thought he was pointing.
No, he's definitely flipping off.
What's now right behind that?
I don't actually. There's a number of possibilities. It could have been someone in the audience. We'll talk about this with Fischer, but Fischer despised the audience. He just despised them. His ideal chess match was a chess match with him, his opponent, and the arbiter present, and that's it.
And the money.
The financier, maybe.
He wanted the people, but he wanted the
money. No, he didn't want cameras, he didn't want flashes, he didn't want any noise whatsoever. And he was certain that everything was making noise, even when they would test it with a decibel meter and show that it wasn't above ambient levels of noise. He would still think it was noisy, even if it was off. And in a lot of the chess that he played, from 67 onward, he started imposing conditions like that they remove the first X rows of seats from the amphitheater so that he would be further away from the audience because he didn't want to hear candy wrappers opening, he didn't want to hear laughing, he didn't want to hear anything. So I would imagine that this is one of those instances where somebody coughed into their hand and Fischer went ballistic, or they said something to their neighbor, you know, and he went nuts. He was not in his best shape. I mean, you can see that he's put on some pounds, and he had to shave and get his hair brushed and beard trimmed specifically for this event. You'll see in later pictures that that he looked like a mountain man. And he was never strong on manners ever. So I think I just put this in as kind of typical Fischer. I guess he was just even more unguarded in his later life. Like, he didn't care what people thought at all. It just, you know, F you sort of thing. But he was nice with Spassky. There was, you know, a couple times where Spassky had beat him. And I don't know if you know, but a lot of chess players don't support losing well at all. And you know, they tend to storm off and or, you know, cry. Spassky cried a couple times after matches. But whenever he would lose to Spassky, he wouldn't actually storm off in a huff. And that was pretty telling. He was pretty much the only player that Fischer was like that with. He would shake his hand. He would stick around 5 or 10 minutes. He wouldn't necessarily talk to Spassky, and Spassky wouldn't necessarily talk to him because, you know, you're not going to review the game, you know, do a little post-mortem. Fischer was not that kind of person, but he would stick around a bit with Spassky on the stage. So there was some respect there, even if Fischer doesn't say it explicitly. In fact, it's kind of funny what Fischer says about Spassky. Kasparov quotes it at the very end.
It's amusing.
So you have all these people who are saying things like, you know, Smyslov is saying, Spassky is a player of enormous practical strength, versatile to the highest degree, blah, 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 blah. Botvinnik, Spassky is a great player. He's a continuation of the Lasker line. Karpov, Spassky was a complete and absolutely universal player. He's equally good at attacking, defending, and accumulating positional advantages. And Fischer says, and I'll read it verbatim, Spassky is, in fact, a sounder player than Tall, but Tall is more brilliant. Spassky has some weaknesses, but he makes it difficult for an opponent to take advantage of them. He doesn't play closed positional chess very well. Still, he always seems a little ahead of you on theory.
So he threw it up.
Yeah, you know, a little backhanded compliment.
You give him the bird. I mean,
No. So there was some, like I said, camaraderie, more from Spassky toward Fischer, but I think that's because Fischer wasn't emotionally capable of reciprocating. Anyway.
Did it hit anywhere in the books where if Spassky actually cared about winning this World Chess Championship?
Oh yeah, when he went into it, he was very confident. I mean, he didn't think he was going to lose. He thought he was going to win, and he wanted to win. There's a couple of points where his confidence was shaken. First, in game two, or when Fischer didn't show up, Spassky was very disillusioned by that, and he was genuinely worried.
In 92,
I don't know what Spassky's mindset was going into that. I mean, Fischer was so much of a question mark. Nobody had really seen him play. I mean, he had played some. He went and lived with the Polgar family for a while until he got a little creepy and they had to be like, okay, Bobby. But Fischer's MO is he'd go couch surf with some people and get by on his natural chess playing ability until he kind of wore out his welcome, then he'd go couch surf somewhere else. But he had never played in a tournament. In fact, he refused to play standard chess. He would play Fischer random chess, you know, where you arrange the pieces somewhat randomly on the back rank and take out the opening theory. That's about the only kind of chess that he would sit down and play in any sort of semi-public way. He would still play privately and do analysis with people, and he played some blitz. There's people who talk about playing in blitz in the 90s and just get swept off the board as if, you know, they were complete chumps. But nobody really knew what his playing strength was going into it. I mean, so much of those tournaments is about preparation. And Fischer worked his butt off to prepare for the 72 World Championship. And, well, Fischer really worked his butt off from an early age onward. It was Tal who said that he worked harder than the whole USSR team combined. But nobody really knew going into it. And Spassky, I don't know if he really... I don't know how much he cared. I mean, he's a competitive guy, sure, but I think he was happy to see Fischer again. Yeah. I mean, Spassky had a friendship with him, and so I think he was happy to try to draw him out and think maybe if nothing else, this will reestablish Fischer as a member of the chess playing community. Didn't happen because.
I would imagine that he would have been confident against Fischer because Spassky was pretty active in chess in previous 20 years, whereas Fischer was almost quite literally non-existent. So you have to think that he was probably thinking he was going to win.
Yeah, there are very few people of Spassky's age who could rival him. Korchnoi being an exception. Korchnoi was really good even at an advanced age. And so, yeah, he's 106th in the world, but if you would look at how many players were older than him that were rated higher than him, it was only Korchnoi. So to his mind, the only person, you know, yes, his chess playing ability has declined, but so is everybody's. You know, that just happens with age. So he doesn't think there are very many people in the world better than him at his age. And that was a justified belief. So I'm sure he probably did go into this match with confidence. And for a while, you know, you can see after game match five, for example, he led. You know, Fischer still played strongly. Kasparov didn't think much of the level of play, thought he played maybe 2,600. You know, Fischer probably played 2,600, but instead of his previous, you know, 2,800-ish. But still, it was enough to decisively beat Spassky.
I was 6 years old when this match happened. Does anybody remember this happening? I don't want to ask specifically.
Yeah, I was 14. I didn't watch it like match by match, but I remember reading about the anticipation of it, and
on TV or something. Maybe not.
It wasn't broadcast on live television. There were recaps every now and then. There were, you know, reporters checking in, but yeah, it wasn't given. I mean, at this point, Fischer's he's disgraced. I mean,
the World Chess Championship.
Yeah.
Now, one other point to mention. So you would talk about finance and how the Soviets, you know, generally take money. Now, in the Soviet chess book by
Soltis,
he mentions that Spassky actually took home most of the money from his earnings in the World Championship.
World Championship?
Yeah. And that he was able to buy a Volvo with all that money. And in Soviet Russia, that was pretty incredible. I mean, even Botvinnik actually scorned Spassky after that because he thought he was being a non-ideal Soviet citizen. Because he was driving a Volvo while everybody else was taking the bus.
Yeah.
You know, that was kind of unprecedented luxury he thought was unpatriotic, basically.
Wow.
And from that one World Championship match, I guess he had surpassed all of Botvinnik's lifetime earnings, so he was probably also kind of bitter and jealous, you know.
Yeah, I mean, Tao, the same critique was leveled toward Tao with his seven televisions, you know, had the television in his bathroom, and people just saw that as un-Soviet, you know. Probably explains partly why they were good friends. I didn't realize he was able to keep most of that money. Well, good for him.
Yeah, it didn't mention figures, it just mentioned what he was able to buy. So.
Yeah, but like most chess tournaments, you know, the winner might take home $5,000 at this time. So to have a $250,000 prize purse was just exponentially greater than any. Like, I think the previous highest total for a world championship was like 10,000 prize pool. So 250,000 was just
nuts.
But
this was like some gangster, right? Who funded it? I forgot who it was.
It was not a gangster. It was a hedge fund guy from Great Britain, a chess fan who was like a banker and. The prize pool was $125,000. That was a bid from the Icelandic government, and Fischer wasn't going to play for $125,000. So this financier stepped in kind of at the last minute and offered to double it with $125,000 of his own money. It's kind of like if Rex Sinkefeld would step in and, you know, and double the budget of the Sochi World Championship so that Carlson would sign the contract. Not quite the same, but similar idea, you know, if this benefactor would show up to make it palatable. Anything else? Okay. Well, thank you, guys. Stuff.